So today's topic for discussion are recent change in ITC rule, key points, impact of the new rule on taxpayer, and how does WeP GST platform help? Okay. So what is this new rule all about? So this new rule says a registered taxpayer can claim ITC to extent of 120% of eligible credit appearing in GST 2A of a particular period to an eligible credit as per books of account. Yeah, so 120% of your 2A, but that should be subjected to eligible credit as per your book of accounts. So this provision was passed on 9th October 2019. So this is effective from 9th October 2019. So any Q&A we'll take at the end of the session. Okay, so now we'll explain the rule with the example. Say scenario one, as per your books, your eligible ITC is 10,000. As per 2A is 7,000. Now 120% ITC of a GST 2A, that becomes 7,000 plus 20% of 7,000, that is 8,400. So as per your books, 10,000. As per 120% of ITC of 2A, 8,400. So out of these two, you're eligible to claim whichever is lesser. If your books is less, you can claim that one. If you 120% of ITC of 2A is less, you'll be able to claim that one. And when I compare these two, this is lesser, 8,400. So out of 10,000, 8,400, you'll be able to claim 8,400 of your ITC. So case two, as per your books, this 8,000. As per 2A, 7,000. Now 120% of 2A, that becomes 8,400. Here again, if I compare 8,000 with 8,400, 8,000 is lesser, so I am allowed to claim 8,000. Yeah, I hope it's clear now. So I'll just repeat this part again. As I said earlier, so it's 120% of your ITC, but that has to be subjected to your books of accounts. So as per your books, you are eligible for 10,000. As per 2A, 7,000. Now I'll calculate 120%. Of 7,000, which becomes 8,400. Then I'll compare with my books of accounts, that is 10,000 and 8,400. Since 8,400 is lower, I'm eligible for 8,400. Same way, 8,000 as per my books, 7,000 as per 2A. 120% of 7,000 is 8,400. Out of these two, lesser is 8,000, which is my books as per my books. So I'm eligible for claiming 8,000. Now the key points. So we are eligible that ITC can be taken for those records which have come under 2A, which my vendor or my supplier has uploaded as a part of GST 1. So I can, this rule doesn't apply to ITC on imports of goods or service, ISD credit, or RCM credits on inward supply. Next point, all this eligible tax credit is not on this, is on the specific tax and not on the aggregate value. Say like you have a tax amount in GST 2A of IGST as 1,000 rupees, CGST, SGST as 2,000. So if I take an aggregate value, that if I take IGST, CGST and SGST together, then 120% of entire things become 4,800. But this is not correct because it's a tax specific. Whatever I can claim is a tax specific. So I need to calculate 120% on each of the tax. Say IGST is 1,000 rupees. I calculate 120% on that, it becomes 1200. So I'm eligible on IGST, 1200 rupees. On CGST, SGST is 2000. I calculate 120% on that. So, and I add it to my 2000, it becomes 2400. So for CGST, SGST, I'm applicable for 2400. So again, it's not aggregate, value, it's a tax specific. So 120% has to be calculated on each tax. Now all this eligible credit is on a consolidated basis and not on based on supplier. So as a, again, tax specific and not based on supplier. Okay, just there's a query, I'll just answer. Okay, there's someone who says, please repeat. And can you let me know which part you want me to repeat? So till now, I've covered. So what is the rule? An example of the rule, how it is, how you'll calculate that, how does it affect your books, and some key points. So do you want me to repeat which one of these? Okay, so I hope the second point is clear. Okay, there's one more question. I'll just take this up and after that we'll take Q&A in the end of the session. Okay, so we'll take the Q&A at the end of the session. Okay, so impact of new rule on the taxpayer. So losing out on genuine ITC claim due to non-filing of GST I-1 by supplier. So we should ensure that not only we are filing time, we should ensure that even our supplier is filing on time. Otherwise, we'll lose out on ITC. So, okay, so deferral of ITC claims where vendors are quarterly filers. Constraint on working capital owing to more cash flow. Month-on-month reconciliation. So we should ensure that we are doing reconciliation every month to ensure that we are not losing out on ITC. Then it requires a continuous follow-up with our vendors for genuine credit. Like say you have done an invoice in your books, but your supplier has not uploaded as the part of GST one. So you have to ensure that they do it. You should do a continuous follow-up with the supplier or vendor and ensure that they upload the GST one return on time and your invoices on time so that you get your eligible ITC. So I'll just repeat the slide again. So impact of the new rule on the taxpayer, losing out on genuine ITC claims due to non-filing of GST I-1 by suppliers, deferral of ITC claims where vendors are quarterly filers, constraint on working capital owing to more cash outflow. Month-on-month reconciliation becomes very important because you need to claim your ITC. You should know your match invoices. You should know your near matches invoices. And based on that, you should claim your ITC. And again, it's a continuous follow-up with the vendors becomes very important. You should, if they have missed out an invoice, suppose you have done an invoice of 10 invoices from a particular vendor. He has uploaded GST one only for 5 invoices. So you have to ensure you have to call them, follow up, say that the other 5 invoices are also uploaded and you get a claim on that. Okay, now consequences, if a non-compliance is there of the rule, so it might lead to differences with the department on the amount of eligible ITC, reversal of ITC claimed in excess limit is specified by the rule. So now suppose you have claimed excess, if you voluntarily disclose that, you are eligible to pay 18% per annum interest on that. Or if your mistake is identified by the officer, then you are entitled to pay 24% interest per annum. So if you disclose by yourself, it's 18%. If the officer finds out that you have made a mistake or claimed excess, then you're eligible to pay an interest of 24% per annum. So we'll just pause here. We'll take some of the Q&A, then we will go ahead with the next part of our session. Yeah. So you can just write all your queries in the chat box. We'll answer those and then we'll move ahead for the next part of the presentation. Okay, so there's a question. What if no ITC is reflecting in 2A, but we have booked 10,000 in our books? So you cannot claim anything in this scenario because the rule says you can claim 20% more. That is 120% on your 2A. Since your 2A itself is zero, you won't be eligible to claim anything. You have to follow up with your supplier or vendor and tell them to upload the GST one so that you can claim the same. Yeah, so I hope that is clear. Okay, so next question is, does the rule say to claim lower of 120% or books balance? No, the rule says, say you can take 120% on your 2A and you'll compare with your books, whichever is lower, you'll consider that. So your books is lower, you'll consider that. If your 120% of your 2A is lower, you'll consider that. So you have to consider the lower value. You have to compare both the values, 120% of 2A and your books balance, and then take a lower one. Okay, so this next question which says, how does 4,800 come? So this I'd explained as an example. I'll just go back to the slide. Okay, so this one, right? So this is the wrong thing. So you I'm just saying you should not do this because this tax says it's a tax specific, like 120% should be considered on each tax. Say IGST, it should be 120% of your IGST, CGST, SGST, again 120%. You should not take all the values and consider 120% on that. If you do that, it becomes 4,800, which is wrong. It's a tax specific, you should calculate based on each tax. So I hope that's clear, like how 4,800 comes, but this is wrong. You should not calculate this way. So the next question says, can't claim up to 120%. No, you can claim up to 120%, but you should compare with your books also. If your book says you're eligible to 1,000 rupees and your 2A says 2,000 rupees, but you cannot go ahead and take 2,000. So even if you add 120%, you cannot take 2,000. You'll have to go with the lower value, which is as per your books. So you have to compare both and whichever is lower, you have to go as per that. Okay, the key point two calculation is not clear. The same thing as I said, like it's a ITC is a tax specific one. So you cannot take all IGST, CGST, SGST together and then calculate 120% on that. You have to take each taxes and calculate 120% on that. That is how much you are eligible for. So like IGST is say 100 rupees, CGST, SGST, another 100. So that becomes 100 each, right? So you're not eligible to take all 100 and make it 300 and calculate 120% on that. You have to take 100 separately, calculate 120%, against the GST, SGST separately and calculate 120%. That's what you are eligible for. Okay, so next question says, can we include the line items with status non-filed in GSTR 2A for ITC calculation? So currently it's not clear, the rule doesn't specify that, or it's not clear that we should consider or not consider. So you can currently go ahead and consider 120% of that. Okay, so next question says how to set off the same in the next month. So I'll come to that. One of my slides will speak on the same. Like if you have got some of the credit in October for say October period, and then October period credit again you're getting in November period. So how do we manage that? That I'll talk about in the next coming slides. Okay, so next question says, those who have filed quarterly, what we should do with that? So you can request your supplier to upload every month. However, you can go ahead with the filing the third month itself. So in that case, you get those invoices as a part of GSTR 2A with the filing status no. But still, you can go ahead and calculate 120% on that. But if your invoice itself is not present, then you won't be able to take a credit on that. At 120%, if you won't be able to include that invoice, basically. So it's better you ask your vendor to upload it. He might not file it. He can file it in the end of the third month itself and the end of the quarter. But currently, he'll be able to upload that. Okay, so next question says, do we need to take YTD numbers for computation or only for a particular month? Because it may be possible that the supplier has uploaded in Jan, but we have booked in March. So you have to take it based on the invoice number, right? Invoice date. So basically, if your invoice number, you have an invoice number which is pertaining to say October. So you have to take October date and then you calculate your ITC 120% of your particular GST to be for October. So based on that, you have to take it. Okay, next question says, can I download 2A on 20th and reconcile and take eligible ITC? So like 11th of every month, your vendor already uploads the data. If it's already uploaded, you have time, like from 11th till 19th, say you can complete your reconciliation and then claim your ITC on 20th based on your 2A calculation. So next question says, what is the mechanism department to verify? So all your 2A data is present with the government. So all your ITC, right, which you claim is calculated based on that. So if you remember initially, there was multiple notices which were floating, right? When you have claimed more ITC as per 3B, but your 2A says something different. So there was multiple notices which came to multiple companies and they were asked to verify the same. So same case, they have all your 2A data, they'll be calculating based on that. So they have given that notice in advance that you calculate 120% on that and claim that much itself or based on your books, whichever is lower. Okay, so next question says the section 73 and 74 came in force, but the proper officer, how does he identify the intention of SEC, either it is a case of fraud or other than fraud? So again, this base, it's based on the case to case. So they'll verify all your records. They'll take all the data of your ITC, how you've been filing and all that. And then based on that, it will be identified whether it was a case of fraud or other than fraud. Okay, so next question says, if my GST 2A shows a credit of 10,000 and my books has a credit of 11,000, so can I claim 11,000? So 10,000, you can take 120% of that and then compare with your books of 11,000, whichever is lower, you can take that. Okay, so if there's a credit of 2A, like say of 2,000 rupees, which your supplier has not uploaded, so there's a question asked like, can we take that? So again, whatever 2A is applicable, you have to take 120% of that. If that 2000 is getting adjusted in that 120%, you can claim that. Okay, can we claim ITC of the invoices which are with the filing status N in GST 2A? As I said, currently it's not clear, so you can go ahead and calculate 120% on the entire value of 2A, even with the filing status N. Okay. Okay, so next question says, what is the date for calculation 120% claiming ITC for register 2A? So you can do it once register 1 is over. So it gets over on 11th. So you can do it on 12th. So you can download your 2A and calculate 120% on that. That is all. So next question says, up to which date GST 2A should we take for finalizing the 3B? So as per circular clarification, it says on 11th, but 11th, since everybody is filing, you can go ahead and do it on 12th. So next question, quarterly filers can be able to file invoice details in GST 1. So again, the rule remains same. They can file only once in a quarter, but there's no objection or no rule that they cannot upload it. They can of course go ahead and upload the invoices every month, and you'll get those invoices in your GST 2A with a filing status of no. So you can go ahead and ask your supplier to upload it, even if they are quarterly filers. So next question says, what about invoices dated September uploaded after 9th October? So again, we have a slide on that, like how does your ITC or credit is carried to the next month, how, what to do in that scenario. I'll cover that in the next few slides. Okay, so next question says, as per recent law, case law, ITC of SSC cannot be vanished due to non-filing of returns by the supplier. So still there's no, like, there's no information on that. I think this due for tomorrow. The hearing is due for tomorrow. Once it's clarified, we can have a word on that. But currently, this there's no verdict or there's no like constraint which has come on this. So currently we need to follow whatever has come in the notice. So next question says, in our case, what are the consequences? Same thing, if you have claimed extra, then you, if you voluntarily declare that, then you're eligible to pay 18% interest per annum. If the officer finds out, then you're eligible to pay 24% interest per annum. So these are, so you should ensure that you don't claim extra. If you're, if you, even if you're 2A, you have got extra invoices, but you should take your books in word logs and then check and then take whichever is lower. So you should always rely on your books, and then again 120% on GST 2A is applicable. Okay, so no, the webinar is not finished. I'm just answering few Q&A and then we'll move to the next slide. So this was a short Q&A session after finishing some slides. So if you have any question, you can also post your questions here. There's a question asking if the webinar is over. So it's not over currently. Okay, so next question says, if I download 2A on 20th, it contains GSTR 1 filed after 11. So can I take eligible ITC for those GSTR 1 filed after 11? So currently, yes, there has been no clarification on that, like if you can or should take or you should not take. So currently you can go ahead and take. So we'll just pause on Q&A for some time. We'll complete our other slides and then go ahead again with the Q&A. Okay, so now we'll take an example where some of your suppliers have uploaded October invoices in the October period itself, whereas there'll be other suppliers who have not uploaded their GSTR 1 for October invoices in October. They have gone ahead and done it in November. So we'll take those cases and explain those scenarios here. Okay, so as per GSTR 2, say your total credit is 10,000. Ineligible is 1,000. So eligible becomes 10,000 minus 1,000, that is 9,000. So this is as per your books. As per GSTR 2 means as per your books, as per your invoice. Now next, as per your GSTR 2A, in tax period October, say total credit is 6,000. Ineligible is 500. So eligible credit becomes 6,000 minus 500, that is 5,500. So max credit for the tax period is eligible credit as per books is 9,000, which is from here eligible credit as per books. Eligible credit as per 2A is 5,500. It's 5,500. Now I calculate 120% on that. So this becomes 6,600. So as per books is 9,000. 120% on GSTR 2A, it becomes 6,600. Now out of these two, I can claim which is lower. So I can claim 6,600. Okay, so this is all about October tax period. I'll just repeat again. Say in GSTR 2, our total credit is 10,000. Ineligible is 1,000. So eligible credit becomes 9,000. As per 2A, say total credit is 6,000. Ineligible is 500. So 6,000 minus 500, it becomes 5,500 for October period. Max credit for our tax period. Eligible credit as per books is 9,000, which I've explained here. Eligible credit as per 2A is 5,500, which is explained here. Now I take 120% in that, which becomes 6,600. Now out of these two, I can claim whichever is lower. So lower is 6,600, so I'm eligible to claim 6,600. So this is on the tax period October. Now say your suppliers uploaded some in October. This is the details of that. Now, some of your suppliers again uploaded October invoices and November period. So how do we deal with that scenario? So I'll just cover that in next slide. Say as per 2A, in November tax period, new credits related to October is say 2,000. Credits already present in October is 6,000, which is here. As per October, it was 6,000. Yeah, which I've explained is 6,000. New credit which came is 2,000. Total credit for October is 8,000. Ineligible out of new credit. Out of new credit, how much ineligible is 500. Ineligible credit in old entries is 500. So total ineligible becomes 1,000. Credit claimed as per books is 9,000, which I've explained earlier in my slide. I'll just show it. So as per my books, eligible is 9,000. Eligible credit as per 2A is A minus B, which is GSTR 2A, and this one, this value and this value. So it becomes, which is 8,700. Now I calculate 120% on that, it becomes 8,400. Now, as per books, it becomes 9,000. As per 2A, it becomes 8,400. So credit which should be claimed is 8,400 minus 6,600, because 6,600 has been claimed earlier. So if you see here, we've already claimed 6,600, so I cannot claim the same value again. So that I'm adjusting here, because out of these two, I know the lesser is 8,400, so I have to go with this value. But since I've already claimed 6,600, I can only claim the remaining 1,800. So I'll just explain this slide again. This example where your supplier has not uploaded all the data in a particular period, they've taken multiple periods to upload the same. Say as per your books, your total credit is 10,000, ineligible is 1,000, eligible credit is 9,000. Then as per 2A, total credit is 6,000, ineligible 500. So eligible credit becomes 5,500. The eligible credit as per books is 9,000, which is from here. Eligible credit as per 2A is 5,500, then 120% on that, which becomes 6,600. And out of these two, whichever is lower, I have to consider, since lower is 6,600. So I'm eligible for credit for 6,600 in a period of October. Next, then I get some more invoices of pertaining to October. Invoice date as October in November 2019 period. Then as per 2A, new credits related to October is say 2000. Credit already present in October 2019 is 6000. Total credit for October becomes 8000. Ineligible out of new entries is 500, like say 2000 I got new, but out of this 500 is not eligible. As per old entry, 500 was not eligible. So total ineligible becomes 1,000 rupees. Credit claimed as per books was 9,000. Eligible credit becomes 7,000, which is A minus B, which is total credit minus ineligible. That's 8,000 minus 1,000, that becomes 7,000. 120% on that, it becomes 8,400. Now out of these two, which is lower? 8,400. So I'm eligible for this credit. But since I've already claimed 6,600 in previous month, this month I can go ahead and claim 1,800. Yeah, I hope it's clear now. Okay, so how does WeP help you in tackling this challenge? So we have a user-friendly 2N2A reconciliation. So you can do your reconciliation and then claim 120% on your DSTA 2A. You can consider your match invoices, near match invoices, and then calculate your final ITC, how much you're eligible. And then we also have a supplier trigger option where you can trigger your supplier saying they have not uploaded a particular invoice. You can use that supplier trigger option to send a mail to your particular supplier. Apart from that, there's also an option where supplier can add a comment. Say if he has not uploaded a particular invoice, why didn't he upload? All that he can add as a comment, and that can be visible to you. So that option can be used. Next, we are also coming up with a new report where you'll be able to pull out a report that how much ITC you're eligible based on your 2A amount and even based on the reconciliation amount of match invoices and near match invoices. So this report will be available in under some time now. So you'll be able to use that report and get a figure of how much you can claim your ITC, right? Because between your GSTA 1 filing and 3B filing, there's not much time, right, to do an entire reconciliation and understand. So this report will give you some idea how much you can claim on ITC. You can just upload your 2, download your 2A, and you'll be able to get this report. Okay, thank you. So you can just, I'll just take Q&A. So you can ask your questions in the chat box. I'll try answering. Okay, so next question says, are we have to compare invoices versus invoice or total amount versus total amount? So see, when you want to follow up with the vendor, it will be of course invoice wise, but when you're calculating 120% of your ITC, it is of course has to be on the total amount. You have to take the entire 2A and calculate 120% on that. That's specific. Yeah, so recordings of this webinar will be definitely sent to all the participants. Okay, so next question says, please display the example of November 1990 ITC eligibility. Okay, so I'll just go back to that slide. Okay. Okay, so on the November period, like say new cadet for October is 2000. Cadet already present in October is 6000, which I have shown in my previous slide. Total cadet for October now becomes 8000. With 2000 coming in November, it becomes 6000 for October and 2000 more in November. Total becomes 8000. Ineligible for the new return, new entry which have come up is 500. Ineligible in old cadet is 500. Total ineligible becomes 1000. So credit claimed as per books is 9000, which I've explained in the previous slide. So it's 9000 here, eligible credit. So eligible credit as per 2A. So I should take the entire total 8000 minus which are not eligible. So it becomes 7000 into 120% of that 8400. Now out of these two, which is lower, 8400. So I'm eligible for 8,400, but since I've already claimed 6,600 in the previous month, I'm eligible for 1,800 rupees for in November month, which is pertaining to October period. Okay, I hope that answers your question. So next question says whether debit or credit note should be taken care for RECO. Yes, so the amount whichever we are displaying here is a net of value. So if you see the amount total credit, when I say total credit, it is your B2B invoices plus debit minus credit. So it's already been considered here when I get that. Yeah, so you'll receive this recording of the webinar. Yeah. So all the participants on the registered email ID, they'll get the recording of this webinar. So any other questions, please write in the chat box. So we'll wait for other 5 minutes. Okay, next question is like when you'll get the recording for this webinar. So you'll get it by this week. Latest by tomorrow or by this week you'll get it. Okay, so next is on, can you provide some words on e-invoicing? So we'll have one more session. So we've already planned for it. So we'll take up that session. In that session, we'll be covering e-invoicing. Okay, so next question says, I have same GSTAT 2 20,000. In my GSTAT 2A 30,000. So how much am I eligible? So again, you should calculate 120% on GSTAT 2A, which is only 30,000, and then compare with your books. Whichever is lower, you are eligible for that one. Okay, so I think there's no more questions. If you have any more questions, you can write to us. So we'll try answering those. So for now, thank you. Thank you for joining. So a recording of this webinar will be shared shortly. Thank you all. Thank you for your time.